Yeah. dreams come true. And all the mountains I could climb if you just put your hand in mine. There ain't nothing in this world I couldn't do.
I forgot what's the music on. You probably can't hear a word I say. at flea market. Keep it in your balance. Pretty cool. I've been told to turn on the news. Let me see.
Nobody builds 5G like Verizon builds 5G. Because we're the engineers who build the most reliable network in America. Thousands of smarter towers with the 5G coverage you need. Broader spectrum for faster 5G speeds. Next generation servers with superior network reliability. Because the more you do with 5G, your network matters. It's us pushing us. It's Verizon versus Verizon. Who wins? You.
I will.
for a ceasefire in the Middle East are growing as Hamas signals it would end its attacks if Israel meets its conditions. But Israel is showing no sign of letting up, with more airstrikes in Gaza overnight. At least 200 people have been killed and 58,000 have been displaced due to the violence. Chief National Correspondent Matt Gutman joins me live now from Israel with the latest there. Matt, what's going on with these ceasefire deliberations? Where are we with that?
There are proposals coming from all over the place, Diane. One of them, as you mentioned, came from Hamas itself. It's got two primary conditions, both of which Hamas is aware that Israel will refuse to meet. The first is no incursions into the Temple Mount. That's where the Al-Aqsa Mosque is. That's probably not going to happen. The other is that Israel not evict the two dozen plus families that live right down this street, just beyond this checkpoint. Now, I'm in East Jerusalem, and there is a controversy over these particular homes. Israeli Jews say that they used to belong to Jews before 1948. These people say, well, you can't just evict us. And this is one of the triggers for this conflict. It's very unlikely that Israel would just allow them to stay. This is a case that is winding its way through Israel's court system, but we won't have any adjudication on it for at least a month. So this is going to go on. In the meantime, as you mentioned, Hamas rockets landing in Israel today. Israel overnight with a massive bombardment, at least 52 airplanes, 25-minute-long airstrike on what it said were Hamas tunnels in the Gaza Strip, also targeting Hamas leaders. So right now, it's unclear how close we really are to a ceasefire, despite all of that mounting pressure from the Europeans, from Middle Eastern Arab countries, and of course, from President Biden and the U.S. as well.
And then as this all continues, the death toll is rising. Thousands of people are being displaced by the violence. So where are those people going?
Some of them are staying in U.N. shelters. Some of them are staying with family in Gaza. A lot of them don't really have a place to go. Gaza is one of the most densely packed places on Earth. It's 140 square kilometers, which is square miles, which is the exact same size as the city of Philadelphia. So we're talking about hundreds and hundreds of airstrikes over the past 10 days. It gives you an impression of how everybody has essentially felt them, even if not every building in Gaza has been destroyed. And that's certainly not the case, but enough have, as you mentioned, to leave almost 60,000 people homeless. So a very difficult situation in the Gaza Strip. The infrastructure there has been crippled. Sewage, water, pretty much defunct at this point. Electricity is running extremely short, as is fuel. Now, Israel allowed in 5 fuel tankers yesterday. Maybe that's enough to keep some of the hospitals going, but we are told they are facing a critical shortage of fuel, which means no generators. And again, hospitals can't operate with at least the generators working. So they are reaching critical situations there in Gaza.
All right. And Matt, Palestinians across the...
The Israelis have gutted their infrastructure, water, sewer. 60,000 homeless.
Young Palestinian boy speaking with the police behind us. This is really the longest protest yesterday here in Jerusalem. There was actually an attack against these police officers, not these particular, but another group a few days ago. A car just rammed right into them before these concrete blocks were there that you see behind me. That's why they installed them. So this is really the flashpoint where those Palestinian families face eviction. And really what made this unique is that it's kind of the first time in history, I've been covering this story for over 20 years, that all Palestinian factions, Hamas, Fatah, in the Gaza Strip, in the West Bank, in Israel proper, in those mixed Arab-Jewish towns, got together and said, hey, we are going to show a show of force today. We are going to tell Israel this is unacceptable. The Israeli Palestinians with Israeli citizenship, basically saying, also stop treating us like second-class citizens. We demand our rights. That was very unique. We haven't seen anything like that, perhaps ever, Diane.
All right, Matt Gutman in Israel for us. Matt, be safe. Thank you.
It's going to be open to certain visitors. One branch of EU leadership has voted to welcome vaccinated tourists and those from countries deemed COVID safe. But it's complicated. Ian Pannell joins us now from London to break it down for us. So, Ian, how would this work and what...
overnight in the legal jeopardy facing former President Trump. The New York Attorney General has now joined the criminal investigation into the Trump Organization. Our chief Washington correspondent John Carl has the latest. Good morning, John.
Good morning, George. And the latest reminder of the legal jeopardy facing the former president, we learned overnight that New York's two leading prosecutors have joined forces in a criminal investigation of the Trump Organization. Last night, the New York Attorney General, which had already been investigating the Trump Organization for possible civil charges, we have informed the Trump Organization that our investigation into the organization is no longer purely civil in nature. We are now actively investigating the Trump Organization in a criminal capacity along with the Manhattan DA. The Attorney General gave no indication, George, as to why the move was announced or what exactly they were investigating. But as you remember, it was the New York District Attorney that had a long legal battle with Donald Trump and the Trump Organization that went all the way to the Supreme Court to get Trump's taxes. They did get Trump's taxes and other financial records. There's been no response yet from the former president, but he has called both of these investigations in the past a politically motivated witch hunt. And of course, the Manhattan DA and the New York Attorney General are both Democrats.
That's right, but all kinds of signs that the pressure is increasing with those investigations. John Carl, thanks very much.
The fallout this morning from that announcement out of North Carolina. No charges against the officer who shot and killed Andrew Brown Jr. The district attorney calling the shooting justified. Victor Rotundo has the latest for us.
Overnight, protesters back on the streets of Elizabeth City, North Carolina.
Protesters since Andrew Brown Jr. was shot and killed has been peaceful.
The DA saying the shooting death of Andrew Brown Jr. was justified.
Based upon my review of the facts of this case, I have determined that the shooting of Andrew Brown on April 21st, 2021 was justified to protect the safety and lives of the deputies.
Brown was killed last month while deputies were serving a warrant for drug charges. Although the long-awaited body camera video from the incident has not been made public, the DA played parts of it Tuesday. You see heavily armed officers running toward Brown's car as he was behind the wheel. One deputy gripping the door handle when Brown puts the car in reverse. The DA saying that's the deputy's arm making contact with the hood of the car. When the car comes to a stop, Brown is boxed in. His house behind him, deputies surrounding the front. He ignores commands, putting the car in drive. The DA said he hits that same deputy again, and that's when they open fire. Brown driving through an open lot as officers continue shooting. When deputies catch up, Brown had crashed into a tree and they called for help. Brown's death certificate stated he died within minutes of a penetrating gunshot wound in the head. The DA finding Brown used his car as a weapon.
The law enforcement officers were duty bound to stay at their ground.
The family's attorneys say they are disappointed, calling the actions of the officers criminally negligent.
The fact is, these officers shot a man in the back of the head and killed him. They fired into another person's house, into their kitchen. They fired in the direction of their own officers, and they fired across school zone during school hours.
The entire interaction between Andrew Brown Jr. and deputies, just 44 seconds. The sheriff here saying that those deputies will not lose their jobs, but will be disciplined and retrained. Guys,
all right, Victor, thank you.
crisis in the Middle East. Israel carrying out more attacks on Gaza as Palestinians across the region state the general strike in protest, with calls for a ceasefire intensifying. This is also shaping up as a test for the Biden administration. Chief White House correspondent Cecilia Vega is covering this from Washington, and Matt Duffin is on the ground in Israel. Hey, Matt.
Hey, Mike, overnight, Hamas offering a truce under two conditions. One, that Israel stop all incursions into the Al-Aqsa Mosque here in Jerusalem. And the other, that it not evict more than two dozen families from the neighborhood you see right behind me now. This checkpoint last night, the site of ferocious clashes between Israeli forces and Palestinian protesters. The Israelis locked here.
If you want to go from I don't got it to I got this, well, then get this. A deliciously bold, smooth espresso drink from Dunkin', like a caramel macchiato, velvet, or oat milk latte. Take a sip of You Got This with Dunkin' Espresso Drinks. Order ahead, plus earn rewards. America runs on Dunkin'.
The hero teacher who disarmed the sixth grader after the girl opened fire inside her Idaho school. And this morning, that teacher speaking out for the first time. Amy joins us with the story. Good morning, Amy.
Hey, good morning, Michael. Yes, it is every teacher's nightmare hearing gunshots ring out inside their school. Well, on this day in Idaho, one teacher confronting the danger instead of running the other way, taking the girl's gun away and likely saving so many lives in the process. This morning, the hero teacher who stopped a school shooting in Idaho earlier this month, now breaking her silence.
It was a little girl, and my brain couldn't quite grasp that. And so I looked at her and I just quietly said, "Are you the shooter?" And she just watched me. And I just walked up to her and I put my hand over her hand and I just slowly pulled the gun out of her hand. And she allowed me to. She didn't fight. She didn't give it to me, but she didn't fight. And then after I got the gun, I just pulled her into a hug because I thought this little girl has a mom somewhere that doesn't realize she's having a breakdown. She's hurting people.
Kristen Knighting, a middle school math teacher, was preparing her students for their final exams when she heard a gunshot from down the hall.
I got up and I walked to my door and I just looked out and I just saw one person in the hallway quite a ways down. And it was our janitor. And I shut the door and I came back in and then I heard two more shots. And so I just told my students, "We are going to leave. We're going to run to the high school. You're going to work hard, you're not going to look back, and now is the time to get up and go."
Authorities say a sixth grade girl pulled a handgun out of her backpack and started shooting inside Rigby Middle School. She then moved outside where she continued to fire.
We heard one gunshot, and then right after we heard another, and we heard multiple kids screaming, and my friends and I were freaking out, and we were hiding in the corner of our classroom.
Three people were injured. Two students and a custodian were rushed to the hospital.
One of the boys just started talking about, "Ouch, I'm shocked." And I just looked at him and I said, "Are you shocked?" And he said, "Yes."
Moments after trying to help the boy, Knighting looked up and saw a gun.
I just knew that when I saw that gun, I had to get the gun.
Knighting hugging the girl as she called 911 with her cell phone, waiting and embracing until police arrived.
After a little while, the girl started talking to me, and I could just really tell she was very unhappy. And I just kept hugging her and loving her and trying to let her know that we're going to get through this together. And so I looked at her, and I just said, "He needs to put you in handcuffs." And she didn't respond. She just let him. And he was very gentle and very kind, and he just went ahead and took her and put her in the police car.
I'm going to upload this.